Association for organizing such a fantastic program for our young budding orthopedic surgeons. A topic that is given to me is tuberculosis of the head. Skeletal tuberculosis comprises 1 to 3% of total tuberculosis cases, and hip is the second commonest, constituting about 50 to 20% of osteoarticular tuberculosis. It is often kept in the exam because it is a diagnostic dilemma. Tuberculosis of the hip mimics several hip pathologies. A little bit regarding the pathogenesis, it is always secondary to a primary focus, which can either be in the lungs, lymph gland, or in the viscera. From this primary focus, through the hematogenous spread, it gets deposited, organisms get deposited either in the bone or in the synovium. In the bone, it can be in the supraacetabular area, in the head, or in the trochanter, or in the so-called Babcock's triangle, which is the inferior part of the neck. If it deposits in the synovium, it produces a synovitis. The synovium gets proliferate, and it goes over and underneath the articular cartilage, destroying the articular cartilage in a patchy manner, unlike in the case of septic arthritis. Because of this patchy destruction of both the acetabular side and on the femoral side, it produces a fibrous ankylosis. Cold abscess can occur, and they perforate the capsule, and they may present in the femoral triangle, ischiorectal fossa, medial, lateral, or posterior thigh. The first, when the patient comes to you in the examination, the first thing is the history. Most of these cases are seen in the first 3 decades, even though it can occur at any age. Males are more commonly affected than females, and tuberculosis is almost always monoarticular. Systemic symptoms like fever, evening rise of temperature, cough, loss of weight, loss of appetite, and night sweats are commonly associated. The presenting symptom is often a pain. The pain may be in the region of the groin, refer to the medial aspect of the thigh, and to the knee. Very often they may come with thigh pain and knee pain. They will have an insidious onset. In later stages of the disease, night cries may be present. Limbing in the early stages will be painful, and in late stages, it can be painless. There can be fullness around the hip joint due to cold abscesses. In late cases, they may present with limb length inequality, deformity, stiffness, pathological dislocation, cold abscess, or sinus. In the past history, they have to ask for history of pulmonary tuberculosis, either treated or untreated, contact with tuberculosis, history of BCG vaccination, and in the family history, they have to ask for family history of tuberculosis. In the general examination, usually they are poorly nourished. They will have a cachexic look. Anemia may be associated. They may have lymphadenopathy, especially in the deep inguinal lymph glands and the external iliac glands. Chest signs of tuberculosis should be looked into, and always look for hepatosplenomegaly. We look at the gait, which has already been dealt in detail. In early stages of the disease, they will have an antalgic gait. In late stages, they may have a stiff hip gait, and in unstable hip, they will have a trundle lumbar gait. On inspection, the attitude and deformity depends upon the stage of the disease, which I will come to in a moment. There will be gross wasting of the muscles in the gluteal region and the thigh. Limb length inequality again depends on the stage of the disease. Cold abscess and discharging sinus may be present in the perianal area, gluteal area, trochanteric area, inguinal and femoral areas. On palpation, there will be local rise of temperature. There is tenderness over the femoral triangle. Bitrochanteric tenderness may be painful. Tenderness may be present. The muscle spasm is present in active stage of the disease. If the hip gets dislocated or subluxated, a globular mass may be found in the gluteal region. Coming to the deformities, it depends on the stages. Tully have classified it into 4 stages, stage of synovitis, stage of early arthritis, stage of advanced arthritis, and advanced arthritis with subluxation and dislocate. In early stages, as you all know, there'll be flexion, abduction, external rotation deformity. In early arthritis, flexion, adduction, internal rotation deformity. And the same deformity will be found in stage of advanced arthritis and in cases of late disease. In the stage of synovitis, this position of flexion, abduction, external rotation is due to the effusion into the joint. There'll be apparent lengthening of the extremity and there'll be restriction of terminal range of movement. In the case of early arthritis, more articular cartilage is getting destroyed. It is an active stage associated with muscle spasm. Flexion, adduction, and internal rotation deformity occur. This is because of the selective spasm of the flexors and adductors and the tendency of the patient to lie on the side. There will be global restriction of movements and apparent shortening of the limb. In stage of advanced arthritis, more of the articular cartilage is destroyed and it goes into a stage of fibrous ankylosis. There will be flexion, adduction, and internal rotation deformity, true shortening, and range of movement is grossly restricted and only a jog of movement is often present. So depending on the stage, in the stage of synovitis, you may get terminal restriction of movement. In the stage of early arthritis, restrictive movement in all planes, while in the case of advanced arthritis, there will be only a jog of movement. And in fibrous ankylosis, you may get again a jog of movement. If it is getting dislocated, you may get increase in the range of movement. Coming to the measurements, in the stage of synovitis, you get apparent lengthening. In the case of early arthritis, apparent shortening. In the case of advanced arthritis, true shortening, which will be less than 3 centimeters. And in the case of destruction and dislocation, you may get more than 3 centimeters shortening. You have to measure the circumference of the thigh and there will be gross wasting of the thigh muscles. Trendelenburg test is usually negative because of the fixed deformities that is present, but in late stages, in an unstable hip, it may be positive. The telescopic will be positive only if the hip is dislocated. Always examine the spine for the mobility of the spine and any spinal deformities, which often follows the hip deformity. The lymph glands should be palpated. It is usually the external iliac lymph gland that is palpable or the deep inguinal lymph glands that will be enlarged and matted. Always examine the ipsilateral ring and the contralateral hip because they have got a bearing on the treatment which you are going to say. As far as the investigations is concerned, we'll have to start with blood investigations like the routine hemoglobin, TCDC, ESR, CRP. The ESR is elevated in acute cases, active cases of tuberculosis, and differential count. They may ask regarding the lymphocyte-monocyte ratio. If the lymphocytes are more, it is associated with good immunity, and if monocytes are more, it is associated with poor immunity. Always ask for an X-ray of the pelvis showing both hips. We'll come to radiological findings later. Ultrasound, especially in cases of early arthritis and synovitis, you may detect an effusion and ultrasound guided aspiration can be done. The CT scan will show the destruction or changes in the acetabulum and the femoral head. MRI is a useful investigation for detecting the pathology early. You can aspirate it and send for synovial fluid studies. And in doubtful cases, you have to do a synovial biopsy, either arthroscopic or open, and send it for the AFB staining, then AFB culture, Bacter culture, PCR, and RT-PCR. X-ray again depends on the stage. In synovitis, they may not show any findings. In early arthritis, they will get extra-articular osteoporosis and hazy and irregular joint margins. And in the stage of advanced arthritis, you get a femister triad, which is juxta-articular osteoporosis, narrowing of the joint space, and peripheral destruction of the femoral head and acetabulum. Shanmugasundaram have classified it into 7 types of radiological classification. It can be normal hip type, the traveling acetabulum type, the dislocating type, Perthes-like, protrusio acetabulate type, atrophic type, and motor and pestle type. And again, it can either be a stable hip or an unstable hip. In the stable hip, you have got the normal atrophic and the Perthes type. In the unstable hip, you have got the traveling acetabulum type, the dislocating hip, the protrusive acetabulum, and the motor and basic type. In the wandering acetabulum, what is happening is the supralateral aspect of the acetabulum is getting progressively destroyed by the disease, and the femoral head gradually subluxates upwards. So it is actually the femoral head following the acetabulum rather than dislocating suddenly. In the Perthes type, because of the affection of the vascularity, which can either be a tamponade due to the effusion or due to tuberculous endarthritis, the head of the femur may lose, or the epiphysis may lose the blood supply, and it will produce Perthes-like changes. In the protrusive acetabulum, rarely the medial wall get involved and the head projects into the pelvis. In the motor and basal type, you can see that there will be a small head within a large acetabulum. The MRI should understand is not specific for tuberculosis. It shows synovial effusion, varying degrees of bone edema, area of bone destruction, and abscess formation. Tissue biopsy, to do, send it for histopathological staining. They may ask regarding the typical findings in tuberculosis, that is the caseating necrosis surrounded by epithelioid cells, the macrophages, and the Langerhans giant cells. The characteristic of Langerhans giant cells can also be asked. Then send it for AFB staining, because nowadays we send it for BACTEC culture, because you get the results early. The PCR and RT-PCR, the PCR will detect only, cannot distinguish between dead and active bacilli, while RT-PCR is a much more useful investigation. The culture and sensitivity, I have already mentioned, in the typical Lowenstein-Jensen's medium, it takes around 6 weeks to 2 months. Regarding treatment, in all stages of the disease, you have to give anti-tuberculous treatment. I'll not go into the details of anti-tuberculous treatment because of the lack of time. You should know about the 99 dots, the fixed drug combinations, and the treatment that is advised under the RNTCP for standard extrapulmonary tuberculosis, for the resistant cases, that is the MDR-TB and the XDR-TB. The traction is also given in all stages, then gradual mobilization and weight bearing and surgical treatment. These are the four methods of treatment. The traction in an abduction deformity, you give bilateral skin traction. It relieves the muscle spasm, prevent or correct deformities. It maintains the joint space and keep the joints apart. In the synovitis stage, the treatment mostly conservative. After getting the diagnosis, you can start with anti-tuberculous treatment. You give traction followed by rest. Rest is followed by gradual mobilization and weight bearing. The surgical indication is only for taking a biopsy. In the case of early arthritis, in addition to ATT and traction, you may have to do a synovectomy and the joint debridement. The examiner may ask you how the synovectomy helps, because the synovium will grow back within a couple of weeks' time, and it carries new blood vessels. So the diseased blood vessels are replaced by new ones, which carries the anti-tuberculous drugs into the joint. The second is the disease load is also reduced. In the case of advanced arthritis, in addition to ATT and traction, arthrolysis may improve the range of movement. Arthrolysis is indicated only in cases where there is a fibrous ankylosis. You remove all the pathological and fibrous tissue, do a subtotal synovectomy, leave the posterior capsule undisturbed to preserve the blood supply, and postoperatively, one can give skeletal traction and start mobilizing as early as possible. Advanced arthritis with subluxation and dislocation, conservative treatment may be effective in children. Especially, Sandhu has shown that it gives 80% healing with ATT and traction. In the case of unsound ankylosis, you may have to do a upper femoral corrective osteotomy. Unsound ankylosis means ankylosis in an abnormal position or a non-functional position. The three methods of treatment that are followed are the excision arthroplasty, arthrodesis and hip replacement. Excision arthroplasty provides a mobile, painless hip joint with control of infection and correction of deformity. It is safe both in the active stage of the disease and the healed stage of the disease. The shortening and instability is unavoidable, but it can be reduced if you give traction for 3 months. 90% of the patients are able to squat, kneel, and able to sit cross-legged, according to the studies by Professor S.M. Tully. Instability can be reduced by a pelvic support osteotomy or by tactoplasty. Tactoplasty is a modification of the standard shelf acetabuloplasty. So this is one where the head, the neck, and part of the trochanter is removed in a girdle stone arthroplasty. Arthrodesis, if the hip is stiff and painful, you can convert it into a stiff and painless hip joint. But there is inability to squat, sitting cross-legged, and kneeling, and it is not acceptable in many of the present-day population. The position of the arthrodesis may be asked. The standard teaching was 1 degree per year of age up to the age of 20, and then a little more. So in adults, you give around 20 to 30 degree of flexion, then neutral to abduction and adduction, and about 5 to 10 degree external rotation. Whenever you tell arthrodesis in the examination, you will have to examine the spine, opposite hip, and ipsilateral knee. And if they are abnormal, don't tell arthrodesis as the method of treatment. And nowadays, the most popular treatment is hip replacement. Never tell hemi replacement, hemiarthroplasty, as a treatment for tuberculosis, because acetabulum is also involved. In healed stages, it is an acceptable procedure with advanced arthritis and sequelae. When will you do the arthrodesis? The classical teaching was 1 year after the healing of the disease, because this time frame varies on various publications. Can it be done in an active stage of the disease? It is controversial because of the fear of reactivation of tuberculosis and implant loosening. But recent studies show that it is a safe procedure with perioperative chemotherapy. The two factors that reduces the risk are adequate surgical debridement and perioperative ATT. In most of the studies, it says that 3 months preoperative chemotherapy followed by 15 months of postoperative chemotherapy. In a recent paper, Wang said only 2 weeks of preoperative and 12 weeks of postoperative chemotherapy is required. As which hip will you do? You can cemented or uncemented. There is no difference in the reactivation or the healing with cemented or uncemented hip implants. To summarize, in the synovitis, the clinical findings are flexion, abduction, external rotation, apparent lengthening, and terminal restriction of movement. Radiologically, it may be normal, or there may be very extra-articular osteoporosis. The treatment is ATT, traction, rest, and gradual mobilization. In early arthritis, the treatment is flexion, adduction, internal rotation, apparent shortening, muscle spasm, and the range of movement will be painful. The radiological finding is osteoporosis, bony erosions, and the joint space is often maintained at this stage. Treatment, in addition to ATT and traction, you can do a synovectomy and joint debridement. In advanced arthritis, flexion, adduction, internal rotation with true shortening, destruction of the articular surface, and reduction in the joint space in the X-ray. And the treatment is you include arthrolysis also along with ATT and traction. In advanced arthritis with subluxation and dislocation, flexion, adduction, internal rotation deformity, gross shortening, there may be gross reduction in the joint space, wandering acetabulum, and continue conservative regimen, excision arthroplasty, arthrodesis, or hip replacement is the mode of treatment. A word regarding children. Children, most of the cases can be treated conservatively. Even in advanced arthritis, because of the great potential for regeneration and remodeling, majority of the cases will recover and you will get a painless hip. You don't tell excision arthroplasty and arthrodesis in children. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr.